This man's name is Anatoly Kuznetsov. He's 40 years old, one of the Soviet Union's leading novelists. On July 30th of this year, Anatoly Kuznetsov, on a trip to England, escaped from his Russian guard and defected. In the lining of his coat, he had sewn this film, copies of the original manuscripts of his novels.
That there is the whole of my life. These are my real books, not the ones as they are known to the reader.
This is the story of a man who got away. And there are men in this building who would like nothing better than to get their hands on him. This is the Soviet embassy in London. Anatoly Kuznetsov will have nothing to do with it. Kuznetsov spent his adult life in that schizophrenic twilight zone, trying to be both an honest novelist and a Soviet citizen. His best-known work in the West is the novel Babi Yar, an account of the Nazi massacres in the Ukraine in 1942. Kuznetsov's story is made of the stuff of classic spy fiction, but it is brutally true. It involves the Soviet secret police, the KGB, a shabby hotel in the West End of London, the Apollo, a favorite place for the Soviet embassy to put up visiting delegations, and sex, too, among the seedy strip clubs of Soho. It is a story of escape and betrayal. Like many good thrillers, a newspaper man is involved. The London Daily Telegraph's Soviet affairs editor, David Floyd, the man in the middle. Someone had given Kuznetsov Floyd's name. Kuznetsov now lives in hiding. He prefers to be called by his first name, Anatoly. Kuznetsov, he says, was the man who wrote what he was told to write, and he wants to forget him. But he emerged from hiding to tell his remarkable, sometimes sickening story of life in the Soviet Union. The interpreter is David Floyd, the man who took Kuznetsov in from the cold. I know that the Soviet embassy has been very anxious to talk to you, and you have flatly refused to do so, even in the presence of British Foreign Office people.
I am afraid of them, even in the presence of British officials, and even at a distance, I'm afraid of them.
Anatoly Kuznetsov, when did you decide to leave the Soviet Union?
Анатолій Кузнєцов, ви коли вирішили уїхати з Совєтського Союзу?
Рішення уїхати було у мене.
The decision to leave I took on the morning of the 21st of August last year.
That was when Soviet troops went into Czechoslovakia. But there have been many things in the past 20 years and more equally horrible. What was so special about Czechoslovakia?
Well, probably for me personally, that was the last drop. After that, I really didn't have any faith left or any hope.
All right, there you are, a Soviet citizen who decides to leave Russia. What do you do?
Because it's very difficult to leave the Soviet Union. Very few people get to travel outside the Soviet Union. First of all, if there is a dossier on you with the police, well, then you won't get out anyway. You've got to have a very good reputation at work. You've got to have made frequent statements about your political loyalty, your love for the party and the government. You must be psychologically and nervously in good form, fit. If you've consulted a doctor, and especially if you've consulted a psychiatrist, you would never be let out. And then for 5 or 6 months, you fill in a mess of different forms.
особенно... Особенно вы рассказываете подробно, какие у вас близкие люди.
You particularly have to put down what people near to you, close to you, you leave behind in Russia. A bachelor has very little hope of getting out. A man with a family has better chances. Then he has children left behind and people related to him. Then you have to go through all sorts of conversations, interviews with people. Sometimes they will tell you to follow the activities of the people who go with you, because they very seldom let you out alone. You have to go out in a group. On my case, they attached a special personal agent to me. I had no permission to leave. I once made a journey in 1961 to France. Since then, for 8 years, they wouldn't let me out. There were foreign publishing houses invited me out. I was invited to Paris by a French publishing firm at their expense, for their money. And it looked as though they were going to let me out. But then the secret police got in the way and I wasn't released. Then I was invited to New York by the Dial Press publishers. They wrote a long letter. They promised to put up $5,000. And then once again at the very last moment they wouldn't let me out. So then I decided to get out at any price. I got ready to try and swim out underwater. Because it's very difficult, this tremendous guard on the frontier everywhere. I took a lot of chances and I was very scared. I trained myself to do this. I trained myself to swim underwater. I can now, for example, swim for 15 hours underwater. Because what I had to do was swim under the water and do it in one night. And only if there were bad weather. I just got a letter from another Russian who actually did manage to do it by swimming. He got out to Turkey in the end. There he met up with a Soviet frontier guard who had also got out to Turkey. And the frontier guard explained to him it was only a miracle that he had got out at all. Lots of people try, but they all get caught. The Russian authorities don't only have radar equipment on the surface, which are good enough even to detect a child's ball floating on the surface. But they also have hydro radar locators underneath the water. And they would have caught me. They would have detected me.
So you decided against swimming out, and you made one more attempt to come out legally.
I made my third effort to get out legally, so that I decided to try to fit in with what the secret police wanted. I knew that if I didn't let me out that time, then I knew I would never get out. Well, I succeeded, but at a very considerable price.
What was that price?
As I said, I had to demonstrate in some way my loyalty. Not only my loyalty, but my anxiety, my willingness to work with the secret police. They persecuted me for 8 years. They demanded that I should inform upon my friends who were writers. Yevtushenko, Aksionov. These are all my friends. I refused. So then they developed a great dossier on me. They got people to attach themselves to me, pretending to be friends. They got women to try to become my mistresses. A lot of these people told me what was happening and warned me about it. My telephone was bugged, my letters were opened. I think there were microphones in my rooms. They knew absolutely everything about me. I had two copies of the magazine America. And suddenly some completely unknown person rang me up and said, "Why on earth do you keep those foreign magazines in your home?" It's already written down in your dossier. So then, in desperation, I decided to show them that I had changed my ways, that I would improve, would behave differently. What you have to do, I said to myself, is to just pretend to yourself, believe that this is the Gestapo. I must escape from the concentration camp. What do they want? In order that they should believe me. That I should inform on my own friends. That would be fine. Let them have their informer. I composed what was probably the most striking, the finest piece of writing in my life. I said that these writers, Yevtushenko, Aksionov, and a group of others, right down to some actors in the comedy theater, were getting ready to produce and publish a frightful underground magazine. That they've got an underground print shop, that they're gathering manuscripts together and money for the job. how the secret police were pleased with this. This was a pure fiction. I even thought I might put in that they were actually planning to blow up the Kremlin, but then I thought that they'd see through that. But it didn't matter. They have no sense of humor. They took it all seriously.
Then what did you do?
I decided to write a really persuasive application. There's a terrific campaign now going on at the moment, preparing for the 100th anniversary of Lenin's birth. If you want to do something in this connection, then everything is possible. I said I wanted to write a novel about Lenin and how he created the Communist Party in London. And I would just have to go and visit all the places where he'd been in London.
So you created a kind of phony project, in a way.
And I made it very, very detailed plan, too. So then they started to work with me and said that they'd let me go to England. And that maybe they would give me some secret task to perform, secret mission.
Перед самым отъездом я должен позвонить и, вероятно, получить это задание.
that just before I left from left Russia, I should telephone and I would probably get my secret instructions. Do you know, I took a chance and I didn't bother to ring up.
Anatoly, do you feel any guilt about what you wrote and reported about Yevtuchenko and the others?
Of course I do. It's by no means excluded that they may have had difficulties. I wrote about it immediately as soon as I was here in the Daily Telegraph. So that the KGB over there should know what I'd done.
That it was a false project?
Yes, of course. But this is such an ordinary, everyday thing with them that this isn't going to surprise anybody.
Yet you know that Yevtuchenko was once greatly admired in the West, and many of his poems were against the Soviet system. So perhaps there was some grains of truth in what you reported to the KGB.
No, of course not. He has no plans to start an underground print shop.
So there you are, on a plane with your shadow, and you arrive in London. Then what do you do?
Well, we found a room in a hotel, which was booked for us, either by the Soviet embassy or people who were very close to the embassy. I don't have the right to choose a hotel myself.
And then you have a plan.
We always, when we come on these trips, have several sheets of paper containing the program of what we are to do, and a copy of this remains behind in Russia.
What I meant was a plan to evade the authorities.
Well, that's a different question, of course.
Tell me about that.
Well, my first problem was to get a few hours of freedom when my agent, my watchdog, wasn't with me. I didn't manage to get that for 4 days. He never took his eyes off me.
You must have been a desperate man.
No. I studied him pretty carefully. I knew his weaknesses.
What were they?
We went walking around London. And he, like any young man, he was simply amazed at the beautiful women, the pretty girls, the short skirts, the mini skirts. I noticed the effect this had on him, and I worked on him with a view to suggest that he should visit the striptease shows. You had to become a member, and he wrote himself in as a Yugoslav citizen. In Russia, we are strictly forbidden to visit anything like striptease, or get mixed up with women. We have to sign a paper saying that we shan't do this. In this way, both of us, both I and my watchdog, became criminals. So this introduced a certain amount of confidence between the two of us. We agreed with each other not to tell on each other. And when he told me that in the evening he absolutely had to meet certain people, that I should have to sit in the hotel, then I said, much better if I were to go and have a look at another striptease, and if it looks all right, then we can both go along there another time. He hesitated for a moment, and then he agreed. And I said, if I don't come back for rather a long time, he shouldn't worry. And he he went off, and while I went off to a telephone kiosk, telephone booth. I telephoned the Daily Telegraph. Tried to get in touch with David Floyd, who speaks Russian. I managed to get hold of him, and we met.
What did you say to him?
I told him I wanted to stay in London, ask him to help me because I didn't know English. But I wanted to hide away from my watchdog, my KGB man. This was a very dangerous step to take. They've got their agents all over the place, all over the world. They used to tell me with a smile that they had agents in all parts of the world, in the most incredible places. Just places you just couldn't imagine. They suggested that I might perhaps go to a police chief, and this police chief might in fact be a Soviet agent. This was just theoretically. So I looked for somebody of whom I could be quite certain. He quickly understood what was the matter, and he helped me, and I shall be grateful to him for the rest of my life.
You know that some Western writers, the American novelist William Styron, have described what you have done as despicable, both in informing and, in fact, in leaving the Soviet Union.
Mr. Styron...
If Mr. Styron thinks that way, well, I'm happy to offer him my flat in Tula. Let him go and try it. They still don't understand just what the Soviet Union is. If Thomas Mann or Bertolt Brecht had been faced with the dilemma of leaving Germany or living under Hitler, what would they have said then?
Although
they left Germany, after all.
If they
had had to save themselves at any price to get away from the Gestapo. In any case, this is a question which I myself can't decide. I ask myself, after all, what would people say if they learned, say that Dostoevsky, say, had written and informed, even falsely, but had informed on his friends. I don't know what to answer. I can only say that neither Dostoevsky, nor Tolstoy, nor Turgenev, none of them lived in Soviet Russia.
Yet Daniel, Sinyavsky, and Pasternak did live in the Soviet Union.
Вы предлагаете русскому писателю только потому, что он русский, садиться в концлагерь?
So you would be advising a Russian writer simply because he's Russian to live in a concentration camp?
У меня маленькая надежда, что не сидя в концлагере.
I have a small hope that not living in a concentration camp, I may be able to say more. I don't know.
What were your feelings as a Soviet writer during the trials of Daniel and Sinyavsky?
Ужас.
Horror.
Did you want to speak out for them?
У меня не хватало мужества на это.
I didn't have the courage to do that.
And where would you be today if you had spoken out?
Если бы я это активно делал, я был бы рядом с ними.
If I'd done it really actively, I should be alongside them now.
Или бы просто меня не публиковали, я бы не смог выехать.
Or I should, they would simply not have published me, or I shouldn't have been able to come out of the country.
The Soviet authorities said you left for the most tawdry of reasons, that you left a pregnant mistress behind.
Я об этом узнал из советской печати.
Well, I learned about this from the Soviet press.
Я пока не знаю, в чем дело.
I don't yet know what they're talking about.
Борис Полевой об этом написал. Видимо, ему больше известно об этой женщине, чем мне.
It was Boris Polyevoy who wrote about this, and apparently he knows more about this woman than I do.
You know, Anatoly, human nature is a very funny thing. No one really likes a turncoat. How do you feel about that?
Что же мне делать, и что я обречен быть всегда конформистом, трусом? Что же мне делать?
So what do I have to do? Am I condemned to remain always a coward, a conformist? What can I do?
Я родился в России, я родился
I was born in Russia. I was born in Russia. I lived there 40 years and I know no other life. And the moment came when I could no longer live that way. What do you advise me to do? Commit suicide? I thought about that.
You know, Anatoly, at the very beginning, a great many people outside the Soviet Union had great hopes for communism. What went wrong?
Communist doctrine, communist teaching is very attractive. And it grew out of good convictions and beliefs. But life, it appears, is a good deal more complex than it appeared to the founders of communism. And we see ancient history being repeated again. The road to hell is paved with good intentions. Thanks to communism, that road has become many miles longer. I only have to mention the name Stalin, and you're bound to agree with me. If that is possible, if it's possible to have millions of victims completely senselessly, that means that the idea itself is no good.
But how is it that the Russian people, with their great sense of nationality, great sense of being Russian, how on earth were they so easily cowed?
Oh, there is in Russia a long, long tradition of tyranny. See, if you were born in a concentration camp and your parents were born in a concentration camp and your grandparents were born in a concentration camp, you see, you no longer imagine any other life. First of all, the Tsars oppressed Russia, and then came communism. There was a little short period, that intermission in 1917 between February and October. That was so small that you can really write it off.
Well, there was another brief intermission, a tiny crack of light created by Khrushchev a few years ago. What went wrong there?
No, no. That was only just a nuance, just a shade. I personally didn't take that seriously. That was really just as if in that same concentration camp you just make slightly more human conditions. You're banned from writing letters and receiving parcels, say, and then for a time you are allowed to write letters and allowed to receive parcels.
Некоторые люди приняли это всерьез, обрадовались и решили, что скоро и ворота откроются.
And see, some people took it all seriously and thought that very soon the doors were really going to open. No, the Soviet regime cannot possibly open the doors properly. It seems to me at the moment when I think about it, it's like some nightmare, some frightful dream. Life is like some constant, unbroken theatrical production. Never say out loud what you really think, but what you ought to say. There are, of course, some people who do say what they think. But these are just people, not very bright people, who are just using set phrases of official propaganda. But a thinking man finds it very hard there. And it's a terrible system of universal informing, universal following. You cannot trust a single person there.
Может, сын доносить на отца.
It's quite possible for a son to inform on his father.
Жена на муж.
Or a wife on her husband.
Уж не говоря, друзья.
Not to mention what friends can do to friends.
What gave you the idea or the sense that it might be any different in the West?
Они изолируют совершенно нас.
They isolate us all from foreigners, but we read books, and sometimes we're able to travel abroad. In order to know a little bit more about the world, I especially learned Polish, so you can buy Polish newspapers in Moscow, and they tell you more about the world than Russian newspapers do. Then, after all, once I was actually in Paris, 9 years ago. But then I also became a criminal. I got away from my group once in Montmartre and got to know an artist who was painting modern pictures. I asked him whether he was allowed to paint pictures like that. He just laughed. I went home with him. He showed me his pictures, said he'd won some prizes for them. I said, this is just a fantastic life. This is just tremendous happiness. He took me to the window. He lived up in an attic right at the top. He said, look, it's all right here. Why the hell do you want to go back to Russia? Why don't you stay here with me? I'll paint what I like, and you can write what you like. And a glass of milk will be... We'll have enough for a glass of milk.
Why didn't you do it then?
It's very frightful for a person who's born in a concentration camp. It's too sudden. I left my wife, whom I loved in Russia, my son. Son who was only just born then. I listened to it as if it was like a fairy tale, something fantastic. You see?
Did you brood on that when you got back to Russia?
All thinking people in Russia think about this and brood on it. You see, it's very difficult. We Russians, we are very fond of our country. Every single emigrant is really suffering from a sort of nostalgia. And then, of course, it's especially frightful for a writer to cut himself off from his people.
Yet, as a writer in the Soviet Union, you were a member of a very select group of people. What I'm really trying to get at is when you sat around with other writers, thinking men, intellectual people, what on earth did you talk about?
Mostly we complain. It's just one long complaint. One of them say he's written a novel and so they won't publish it. Or else they publish it in such a frightful form that he's simply desperate.
Isn't that dangerous, though? Well, just where do you draw the line in these conversations? Can you really ever trust each other?
A 100% you can't trust anybody. You have to carry on your conversations like this. You say, this is very bad, and this is bad, and this is bad, but these are all mistakes. But, altogether, we are communists. We just think that there are little small mistakes committed in Russia.
Anatoly, I've read everything you've written, and one word keeps coming up in almost every article, the word cynicism. Could you expand on that?
I am, at this moment, a very fortunate person. I am, for the first time in my life, saying what I really think. Many, many people in Russia think exactly the same as I do. I'm responsible for my words. I know what I'm saying. Insofar as we have to live in that theater. Every single person has a sort of collection of phrases which he speaks and says officially, publicly. And a corresponding collection of actions. Insofar as to a normal human being, it's extremely difficult to lead such a double life.
What are the rewards for that cynicism?
Well, of course, he gets the possibility of living more richly than others, being better off than others. He can buy commodities in special shops. He will be allowed to travel abroad. He may receive decorations, official state medals. State prizes.
Do any of your colleagues place any real value on these awards?
No. On the whole, we're pretty cool towards the sort of rewards you get. My novel, Babyi Yar, was put forward for a state prize. It used to be called Stalin Prizes. But when this was reported in the newspapers, a lot of very decent people began to change their attitude towards me for the worse. Fortunately for me, I didn't get the prize.
The Soviet authorities were very unhappy with your novel, Babiyar. Now, I know that book, and it's a simple account of how the Nazis slaughtered hundreds of thousands of Jews and Ukrainians in the Ukraine. What on earth did they object to in that?
There were three main objections to the book. But in the first place, there is a great deal of anti-Semitism in the Soviet Union. And Babi Yar is primarily concerned with the murder of Jews. The Soviet officials prefer not to talk about this. Then my novel went rather further than this. It begins with talking about the beginning of the war and inquiring why there was such a terrible defeat at that time.
Дело в том, что многие русские люди, особенно украинцы, ждали Гитлера как избавителя.
See, the truth of the matter is that a great many Soviet citizens, and especially Ukrainians, waited for Hitler as a liberator.
Потом оказалось, что он им предлагает такой же террор, как и Сталин.
Then it turned out that the Germans were offering them the same kind of terrorist regime as Stalin.
Народ оказался между двух огней, между молотом и наковальней.
So the people found themselves between two fires, between the hammer and the anvil. The ordinary citizen preferred his own Russian form of terror. And the third objection on the part of the censor was purely literary quality, my literary methods.
Они считают, что они знают лучше, чем я, как мне нужно писать.
They consider that they knew better than I how I should write.
Поэтому там была сделана такая масса купюр, переделок, что роман просто...
Consequently, they did such an enormous number of cuts and changes that the novel, in fact, was turned upside down.
Все мои романы...
And all my novels have been treated in the same way.
Я стою всегда перед дилеммой. Или печатать хоть что-нибудь, или ничего.
So I'm always faced with the dilemma of printing at least something or publishing nothing at all. But in the end, it became so objectionable to me what they're going to print. Well, I simply reject the whole of it.
Now, in coming out, you didn't really come out alone. You came out with everything you'd ever written. How did you achieve this?
I'm a bit of an amateur photographer, and I took pictures. All my manuscripts, put them onto film. I'll show you some of them. I've got them here. Well, that's the sort of thing, just ordinary film. I managed to get six sheets, or typing sheets, onto each exposure. You see, if you brought it all out as actual manuscript, well, it would make something like five or six cases. So I squeezed it, wound it up really tight, and it didn't take up much more room than that cigarette pack. I put, I hid it inside my jacket. And that really was the whole of my possessions, the whole of my property with which I came out of Russia. And that there is the whole of my life. These are my real books. Not the ones as they are known to the reader.
You've left your homeland, as restricted as it was your home. Do you think you'll be able to find the things that you're searching for in the West, or will you always remain Kuznetsov, the man who left?
Конечно, я делаю совершенно отчаянную попытку сделаться другим человеком.
Of course, I'm making an absolutely desperate effort to turn myself into another person.
Мне неприятно, когда называют меня Кузнецов.
I don't like it when people call me Kuznetsov. This is a compromised name.
Только будущее покажет, смогу ли я быть настоящим художником.
Only the future will show whether I can be a real artist and writer and a person.
Well, we in the West have all sorts of problems. Vietnam and other things that are tearing our society apart. Have you ever thought about any of these things?
Да, конечно.
Yes, of course.
Я считаю, что война во Вьетнаме продолжается только из-за Советского Союза.
I consider that the war continues in Vietnam only because of the Soviet Union.
Но если насчет Америки со мной согласятся многие мыслящие люди в России.
As for America, there's a lot of thinking people in Russia who think the same as I do.
То насчет Вьетнама гораздо меньше.
But rather less, as far as Vietnam is concerned.
As a thinking man in the Soviet Union, did you regard the United States as a threat to peace, as a threat to yourself?
Я слишком мало живу на Западе и слишком мало еще имею информации.
I've been living too short a time in the West and have too little information.
Я совершенно не знаю Америки.
I have no knowledge at all of America.
Я очень хочу туда
поехать. I very much want to go there.
Но сейчас и давно, и постоянно, мое личное мнение...
But now and for a long time, my personal opinion...
Что агрессором
is...
в этом мире является Советский Союз.
That the real aggressor in the modern world is the Soviet Union. They don't conceal their aims. They say that communism spread over the whole world. That the, after all, the Western world, including America, defends itself.
You know, even here in the West, one of the great conflicts at the moment for writers is a writer's commitment, a writer's involvement in politics. Do you feel that even here you must engage yourself?
Oh,
God, how I'm tired of all that. I don't want to have anything to do with politics. You put me political questions, but my answers are the answers of a dilettante.
Мне очень нравится писать.
I really like writing.
Художественно писать.
Writing literature.
Там я дошел до такого положения, что больше не могу жить, там я не могу этого делать.
So there I got to the point where I felt I couldn't live there anymore, I couldn't do it there.
Я попробую это делать здесь.
So I'm going to try to do it here.
Вот на это я только надеюсь.
That's all I'm hoping for.
You call Russia a concentration camp, yet you've left your own family back in that concentration camp. Do you fear for them?
Очень.
Very much indeed.
And do you think the Soviet authorities will make them pay for your crime?
Не сомневаюсь.
I have no doubt about that.
And so you feel some guilt over that too?
Да. Да.
Well, even here in the West, you're living under strain, under great tension.
Да.
How long can a man go on living like that?
Не знаю.
I don't know.
Мой агент Энджи Фаридзе рассказывал мне много случаев, какими совершенно невероятными способами они могут убить человека или воздействовать на него. Они закуривают при вас сигарету, открывают портсигар, и в это время у вас вылетает крохотная иголка с тианистым калием. Ну, это уже не имеет отношения к делу, но просто я и пояснил.